Hi everyone. Today I'm going to talk about how you can protect your browser zero day so you won't leak your precious exploits. Most of you know me, so I'm not going to detail all of these things. These are basically the things I'm proud about. I'm the creator of the zombie browser toolkit, the hardware firewall bypass tool, the malware analysis sandbox tester tool, and I also played with some crappy IoT devices, which I presented on the last CAN++. My presentation won't be a linear presentation, and I'm still struggling with it, how I can make it linear. So it could be a little bit confusing, but I will try to help you to guide in the direction how you should understand the presentation. So I am always giving you this table of contents, what I'm going to talk about. First in my presentation, I will introduce you to the elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman key agreement protocols and how I use this in my Iron Squirrel project. I will talk about the attacker model and who is my attacker and things like that. I will talk about why this tool I created is different or new from previous things. And last but not least, I will talk about both defense and offense and how things can be improved on both sides. So there is always a story how did this begin. And I had a discussion with these next generation protection vendors, or we can call these breach detection protection vendors. And they told me that their network appliance will detect all the browser exploits. And I told them that I can create browser exploits in a way that can bypass their protection and they won't be able to detect anything. And guess what? They told me that it's impossible. So what is the logical conclusion for things like that? I go home and I start to code something to prove them wrong, as always. So why will this talk interesting to you? If you are an exploit broker or you are from law enforcement, hands up. Yeah. So I'm going to show you an effective way how you can prevent your zero-day exploit code being leaked. Maybe there are some pen testers here, and this tool can be also used to bypass perimeter defenses. There are easier ways to bypass perimeter defenses, but this works as well. And if you are working as a blue team member or forensic investigator, or you are researching exploit kits, then it's a very interesting thing to see how the exploit kit landscape can change in the future. And if you are none of these, then you can learn about elliptic curve cryptography because it's always fun. Okay, so let's start with the introduction, and I'm going to talk about exploit kits and how exploit kits were used in targeted attacks with zero-day exploits. I will talk about briefly Diffie-Hellman key agreement, elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman key agreement, and how this can be used in encrypted browser exploit delivery, or so-called Iron Squirrel, and how my idea was already implemented by the bad guys. So an exploit kit is exploiting a vulnerability, and when it comes to browser exploit kits, they are exploiting vulnerabilities in a browser. So if you have a zero-day exploit and you are attacking your targets with your zero-day exploit, and the code gets leaked and it gets patched, and there will be some signatures to detect your exploit code, then you are losing your money because it's not that worth anymore. And this can be a problem if you are in law enforcement or if you are an exploit broker, right? For example, there was this very famous case with Ahmed Mansour, who was targeted multiple times with different techniques. And one of the most known technique was when an iOS Safari zero-day exploit was used against Ahmed Mansour. And at the time when this exploit was used and it was leaked, zero-day iOS exploit was something like between $100,000 or even $1.5 million worth. So if you are leaking this code, you are losing a hell of a lot of money. A little side note, Mansour was able to detect the attacks, so he forwarded the phishing, spare phishing URL to a special team, and they were able to analyze the code, so it was patched. But unfortunately, it didn't really help Mansour at the end because he's still in prison. So this is how it works in the UAE. Another very famous example was the Tor browser zero-day exploit when the FBI used it on a pedophile site. And at the time of this, it was around worth $30,000. And the exploit code was basically leaked almost the same day, and it was patched the next day. So the FBI basically had to cancel this whole operation. Now, let's talk a little bit about Diffie-Hellman key agreement. This picture is from Wikipedia, and I believe it is a very good way to explain how Diffie-Hellman key agreement works, if you don't know how this works. So let's say that we are working with paint colors, and Alice and Bob wants to agree on a secret color, but they can only transport colors in a public way. How can you do that? So they both agree on a common paint, like a yellow, and they both choose a secret color, and they mix the common paint and the secret color at home, and they transport this mixed color in public. And let's assume for a second that it is hard, very hard to get the original color, even if you know that the common paint they used was yellow. For me, it is hard. I have to Google for that, but that's a different story. And now that the other party has this mixture of common paint and the other party's secret color, if they mix it with their own color, they have the same color, as you can see, and this can be used as a secret for later. For example, if we are talking about encryption, this can be used for AES key or something like that. This is very old, more than 40 years old. But if we are talking about modular arithmetic, here is a very nice animated GIF I found on the internet how this works. So basically, you get a generator number, which is 2, and you get the 13 as the, it can be seen as, for example, the clock. And if you multiply the generator number by itself, then you can see this basically number is bouncing on the circle. And if you are using big enough numbers, it is very hard to see how you get there. So for example, if you want to know how I got into the sixth position, you have basically have to try all the different combinations to get there. But in order to calculate this, it is very easy. After this Diffie-Hellman key agreement has been used for a while, there was a new, advancement to this field called elliptic curve-based Diffie-Hellman. And jumping to the conclusions, elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman is important because the key generation and key agreement is a lot faster than it is with Diffie-Hellman. And when I implemented my code, this was very easy to see that with Diffie-Hellman, the current CPU and browser and JavaScript combination just simply doesn't work. But when it comes to the math of the elliptic curve-based Diffie-Hellman, it is similar to the previous Diffie-Hellman that you see basically a bouncing ball on the table, but you have no idea how it got there. In elliptic curve cryptography, you have to choose basically a curve, which is the red one, and you have to choose two points on the curve. And after, you can define this very nice math, which is already animated here. And if you do this kind of math long enough, you will get to a point which is, again, easy to calculate in one direction, but very hard to calculate into another direction. I hope you all understand elliptic curve-based Diffie-Hellman based on this one. Unfortunately, I don't understand it better if I go to the details, so I cannot explain to you that. But for my presentation, it is really not needed. So this is basically the whole idea I will talk about today, my Iron Squirrel project. And I implemented this as an basically an exploit kit framework module. So let's say that there is a client who browses the internet and he or she visits a website I control. On the second step, when the HTTP GET requests comes to my site, I can generate my unique elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman private key, and I will send back to the client in the first step a bunch of crypto libraries which will handle this whole Diffie-Hellman key agreement. I will send the curve and the two points on the curve for use as the ECDH parameters, and I will also send my public key to the client. In the next step, when the browser renders all this and JavaScript and HTML stuff, then it will generate its own private elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman key, and now because it already has the public key of the server, it can generate the common secret. In the next step, the client will send the public key to the server, so the server can also calculate the common secret. And now the server can send basically an encrypted blob to the client, which will be encrypted based on this common secret. And now the client can decrypt this encrypted blob and run this via JavaScript eval, for example. And this decrypted JavaScript code will serve as an exploit to the client. And from now on, it's the same as you can see always. The exploit shellcode runs on the client, it will do whatever it wants, but usually it just reaches out to the server to download a malware, for example. You can download also an encrypted malware, so you can see the malware itself on the wire and start the malware locally on the client. First, I want to show you this elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman or as I call it, my Iron Squirrel project in Chrome, without any exploits. So I will just show how this evil stuff works. Shit. Where can I hide this? Shit. Okay. So let's start again. So here is the browser visiting a website, and here you can see that some JavaScript code started on the in the client browser. And let's see what we can see in the document object model. Here you can see some random strings, basically, which is encrypted. And here you can see some other random script. As you can see, this random script was executed as eval, so it will just execute in memory. But let's see what happens if we try to decode what happens here. So we just use the console log function. And yeah, here I'm also showing you what you can see on the wire before it was interpreted. But again, this is just the same stuff. And here you can see that I was able to decrypt the whole encrypted blob. And here you can see the JavaScript code which was running inside the browser. This was possible because I intentionally didn't delete the common secret from the document object model. The common secret is still in the memory. That's why I was able to decrypt this code what was running. But without, as you will see later, without the common secret, it's not possible to decrypt this. Okay. So I implemented the very first version of this Iron Squirrel project around 2 years ago. And I implemented it in Node.js, which might sound a very strange choice. But it turned out it was a very good choice, because if you use Node.js, you can use the same crypto library on the client and on the server. And it took me basically one day to implement this, even though I never used Node.js before, ever. And this year, I was thinking that this project might be worthwhile to import into Metasploit. So I started to recode the project into Ruby and with some JavaScript libraries. And it took me basically 1 week to port the Node.js implementation to Ruby. So the same crypto can be used on JavaScript level and in Ruby. And it was not always fun. But the good news is that this implementation is already tested and compatible with the Edge browser, IE 11. I cannot use IE 10 or older versions because they can't handle any crypto, basically. It just sucks. It's compatible with Firefox or with the Tor browser. It's compatible with Chrome, Opera, Mobile Safari, Mobile Chrome, Android built-in browser. So basically, it works in every modern browser. And 2 years ago, when I created this project, my focus was on bypassing these next-generation bridge detection systems. So I made a blog post about this, and I tweeted this. And it was very, very popular and famous. I got 3 retweets and 3 likes. Yeah. But turned out that someone was really reading my blog, and the bad guys implemented my whole idea in 2 months. They implemented it with some differences. One very huge difference that they did not encrypt the whole exploit code. They only encrypted the SHA code, which really made sense because they were not using any 0 days, but what they were really interested in, that if they protect their SHA code, then the antivirus companies will have a hard time to get their malware payloads. So that's why they did this, and because they had to target older versions of IE, they couldn't use elliptic curve cryptography, so they had to choose the regular Diffie-Hellman, which will be important in the next slides. So yeah, I don't think this is a coincidence that I published my research and 2 months later someone from the bad guys implemented this. As it turns out, if you try to generate secure enough Diffie-Hellman keys in older versions of IE, then the JavaScript is so slow that it takes ages. So the exploit kit developers had to make a trade-off, so they opted for the shorter keys, and the guys at Kaspersky found out that with some crypto and math magic, which I couldn't really understand, they were able to basically factorize these short Diffie-Hellman keys. So they were able to crack the keys and decrypt the shellcode. For me, this was interesting because it showed me that for a huge antivirus company like Kaspersky, this Diffie-Hellman encryption of the shellcode was a real pain in the ass, and they really had to go into great length to crack this. If you are following the exploit kit scene, you will be able to see that first the Angular exploit kit implemented my idea, after that the Neutrino exploit kit, and now the Angular guys are behind bars. There is a very cool YouTube video about how they were catched by the Russian police. It's very interesting to see. So for years, there was no exploit kit in the wild which were using the Diffie-Hellman encryption, but this May, the Astrum exploit kit came back with this Diffie-Hellman exploit delivery. So yeah, I made this slide to show the feeling of the exploit kit developers when they found out, that they can't use elliptic curve cryptography because they had to be compatible with the old version, which are vulnerable. So yeah, they were very sad. Now let's discuss about the attacker model. And in the following slides, I will talk about, in this case, who is my attacker, which is basically the reverse engineer who tries to understand my exploit code, and also all these perimeter defenses. And I will also explain what are the capabilities of the attacker. No wonder the reverse engineer can record all the traffic with a tool like Wireshark, and he will be able to replay this. What this replaying really means, I will explain shortly. And surely reverse engineer can debug my JavaScript code in the browser itself, and the reverse engineer has access to the whole document object model. And usually, but not always, the reverse engineer has access to the assembly level debugger, so he can attach a debugger to the browser. But when it comes to, for example, iOS, if you are testing with a recent version of iOS, which you cannot jailbreak, then as far as I know, there is no way to debug it on the assembly level. So this can be platform specific, whether you can do this or not. So what can a reverse engineer see if he goes to network forensics? First of all, it will be able to see a bunch of crypto libraries in JavaScript, the public key exchange, and some encrypted blobs, and without the command secret, the reverse engineer can't do anything with these encrypted blobs. But if the reverse engineer has live access to the exploit kit, he can use the browser to debug it, but I will later show you how the attacker can make this debugging a lot more harder. So why is this different? Why is this new? I got this question a lot from different people, and it turned out that it is not evident to see why this is interesting. I have seen in the past that the browser exploit code was protected, but it was always some kind of obfuscation because it was never a real encryption. Even when encryption was used, the key was next to the delivered code, so it just became a simple decryption if you are a reverse engineer. And with this encryption, the game changes a lot. I will talk about why is this different than SSL or TLS-based exploit delivery, which we have already seen in the past. And I will talk about this magical exploit replay and how this Iron Squirrel module affects the exploit replay. And I will also talk about why is this different from Stagosploit. Okay, so let's talk about SSL TLS. If you are the reverse engineer, you can control the client, and if you can control the client, then man in the middle in the TLS is very trivial because you can just insert your key into the trusted key store and you can man in the middle the traffic. And if you can man in the middle the traffic, you basically downgrade the whole SSL encryption to just the plain HTTP. And this TLS man in the middle is already prevalent at some of the enterprises. Or if you are a reverse engineer at home or at your lab, you can do this man in the middle very easily. In the past, whenever there was a new, for example, zero-day exploit kit, what people usually used that they had this network dump, and they were able to load this network dump into a replay server, for example, and they were able to reproduce the whole exploit process as many times as the reverse engineer wanted. And this was the case with the iOS zero-day exploit as well. There were no details, so there is some kind of assumption from my side. But what I believe really happened that the guys who analyzed this iOS zero-day exploit, they never ran any debugging on the iOS browser itself. They were just sniffing the network traffic, and when they had this network traffic dump, they were able to reverse the whole exploit from that. As mentioned, if it's in SSL TLS, it can be replayed. But if you use my Iron Squirrel project, then the whole exploit replay process breaks. Why does it break? Because the client will generate a different both private and public key, and the client will send this different public key to the replay server. And from this point, the replay server can either send the encrypted data to the browser, encrypted with the old key, which is unknown to the browser, or it can just stop because it doesn't know the new common secret. But let's show this exploit replay in action because it really explains more. This Fiddler web debugger is a great tool for exploit replaying. And here I am using IE11 with this MS16051 vulnerability. And in this first demo, I am not using Iron Squidera, so there is no encryption process. Here you can see that my shellcode was able to run and the exploit succeeded. And let's see what we can see on the network. And this is the autoresponder module in Fiddler, which we can use for this exploit replay. And as you can see, here is a new rule. If the client wants to access this specific URL, then reply this content which we just sniffed from the internet. And now if I start Fiddler, start the exploit process again, you can see that the exploit just runs the same because nothing changed. And it's not easy to see, but the second request on the left side with this blue background shows that this request was replayed, so it was not served by the web server itself, it was served by the Fiddler proxy. Now let's try again this exploit, but with my Iron Squirrel module included. And here we can see that the exploit works the same, because there was no replay in this case. And here you can see that a lot more requests were made. And as I mentioned, these are basically the crypto libraries, the Diffie-Hellman key agreement, and the final exploit code delivery. Now, if I enable the replay and I try to replay this traffic, then you can see just nothing happens because it breaks somewhere. And here you can see that it was marked with a 404 because what really happened here, Fiddler is explaining to us that the client requested a web page which was not added to the autoresponder tab. And this happened because the client was sending a different public key, and there, because the way Fiddler works, it wanted to replay a content to the specific request, which it didn't have. Of course, we can configure Fiddler in a way that it will respond with the same response for all the public keys we send to it. But as you will be able to see, it doesn't help at all because different keys will be used on the client and on the server. Yeah, IE debugger is a bit buggy, so we have to restart it. But here you can see the error, GCM tag doesn't match, which is a very cryptic error, but it really means that different keys were used on the client and the server, so it's not possible to replay our exploits. Which concludes that it is a one-time shot of the reverse engineer if he can access a live web server. But if he misses that one-time shot, then there's a problem. Okay. Can you guys follow me? Okay. Why is Iron Squirrel different than Stegosploit? I also got this question from many people, but the main difference is that Stegosploit encodes the browser exploit, and it uses steganography in images, which means that Stegosploit is good at hiding your exploit code, but it is replayable. So any determined attacker can replay it anytime and debug where the exploit really happens. And there is no wonder here. Stagosploit can be combined with Iron Squirrel for extra fun. I also got the question that encrypted exploit delivery is not specifically new. For example, we had this Heartbleed exploit in the past. And if you know the Heartbleed vulnerability, you know that this whole exploit can be triggered both in clear text before the handshake finishes, or you can send the exploit code in the encrypted channel after the handshake. And whenever attackers used the clear text attack, it was easy to create IDS signatures to do that. But when it was encrypted, it was a lot harder to detect it. I think the main difference between Heartbleed and Iron Squirrel is that in Heartbleed, the exploit was used because the encryption was part of the protocol itself. And in Iron Squirrel, encryption is an additional module to make reversing actually harder. Now, let's talk about defense and offense, and if you use Iron Squirrel, how you can make defense a lot harder, and if you are a blue team member, how you can beef up your defense. So we will talk about prevention and detection on the network level, how you can analyze Iron Squirrel on the endpoint, how to make the endpoint analysis harder. Because now the exploit replay is not possible anymore, it is a very good strategy to use one-time URLs, which means that you only deliver your exploit once. For example, if you use spear phishing, it is very easy to implement this because you send a unique URL to every target, and once that unique URL was hosted, the URL is dead. For example, Hacking Team used this same method in their exploit kits. If you are working for law enforcement and you are using your exploit code on an Onion website, for example, what I can really recommend that you use your exploit once per logged in users. And the one-time URL is implemented in my Iron Squirrel project because it's basically one line of code. You can also put time limits into your process. So if there is a significant delay between two different HTTP requests, that can mean that someone is manually debugging your code. So you don't really don't want to allow that. So just break the process if some amount of time just happened. It is also important, but not it. It can make analysis a lot harder if you remove the whole document object model after the exploit runs, which was easier to implement than I thought. And now I'm going to show you the Tor browser exploit kit and how it integrates with Iron Squirrel, because it will help to understand the slides later. Okay, so here I set up Wireshark for the HTTP port. And here I am visiting my exploit from the vulnerable Tor browser. And here you can see the document object model shortly. And this is what really happened with my browser, that I tried to scroll down, but because the exploit was already running, I was not able to scroll down, so I was not able to see the full code. Okay, I got back my console, but now the document object is cleared, so I cannot see anything there. And if I check what was inside, what was sent to the browser, I can basically see these encrypted blobs and crypto libraries, but nothing else. And if I just copy back and I try to use the same trick I showed you with the Chrome one, that let's just see how I can decrypt this whole blob. Then I get back an object, which was basically the result of null, because in my attacker code, I cleared the session keys immediately after it was not needed anymore. And if you're familiar with the Tor browser exploit, how it worked, it was basically contacting a web server. The URL is just random. It's a fixed static random in the exploit, so it doesn't really matter what it is. But meanwhile, it leaks in the host header the name of the machine name, and as the cookie, the MAC address is leaked. And because this whole HTTP traffic was bypassing Tor, the FBI was already able to see my IP address. And with this free information, they can basically locate the node, the computer which was used to access this Onion website. So as you can see, it's now a lot harder for the defenders to reverse engineer what really happened here, because if someone posts this code on the internet, as it happened with the Tor browser exploit kit, no one can do anything with this. The reverse engineer needs live access to the exploit itself to debug it. Yeah, so these are just a bunch of encrypted blobs. Okay, so if you are on the defense side, how can you prevent these Iron Squirrel attacks? First of all, you can try to detect that some encryption happened here, and you can try to detect, for example, the crypto libraries, or here is some encrypted blob which has high entropy and I really don't understand. Issue with this that this can be easily bypassed and it will lead to a lot of false positives, so I couldn't really recommend this technique. And as always, there are non-Iron Squirrel specific blocking methods you can use. For example, you can block access to uncategorized or new domains if you are using a fancy web proxy, or you can just use domain whitelisting. But even if the defenders use these methods, if you are a very powerful attacker, you can bypass these. For example, if you use watering hole and you can deploy your code on a website which is already in the whitelist, then you win. Or if you are the NSA and you can use the quantum insert techniques, then nothing can stop you. But if you are not the NSA, you can probably not use this quantum insert technology. Okay, so how you can analyze these iron squirrel exploits on the endpoint? That's now the question. You can try to log the shared key or the client private key, or which sounds easier than it really is, because if the attacker changes the code every time, then there is no automated way to log this. You can try to fix the random generator on the client, so it will generate the same client keys every time you basically replay the attack. Or the following is basically the same, but on a different level, that you can hook the JavaScript code to return with the same client secret key. And also, if you want to analyze iOS Safari exploits, you can use the remote debugging feature on OS X, which I didn't know that it works, and there is something like this. Or last but not least, you can get a detailed JavaScript execution trace log. And it turned out that there is a very great Hungarian project to do the exact same thing. And you can check this project on this GitHub page. And I'm going to show you a demo about this, how this works. I'm going to use the same IE exploit I showed you with the exploit replay. And here you can see that this Evilizer project is used, and it's basically a debugger attached to Internet Explorer, and it basically hooks the eval function in JavaScript, and whenever eval is called, then the first argument what is used in eval is logged. Yes, here you can see that I visit this exploit site, and as you can see, it already starts to logging all the evolved JavaScript code, and now the exploit was able to run. But here you can see the whole JavaScript code which was used in this exploit. So if it were a zero-day exploit, it can be logged via this way. But what can you do as an attacker to prevent these analyses? You can detect the debug window in the browser, and there is a GitHub project for that, which I didn't implement in my project. I really recommend you to do a proper fingerprinting of the target before you deliver the exploit to it. You can obfuscate your code a lot. And as I previously mentioned, the reverse engineer can fix the client key, so it will generate the same client key in every session. But from my code, I can test it, whether the same client keys are generated on every try, and if the same client key is generated twice, then I know that they are using this trick, so I can break the exploit process, and I already implemented this. I think it is very powerful if you basically blow up your code and you add a lot of junk code, and it can delay the analysis by days or even weeks. But in order to bypass Evolizer, it turned out that there are around 40 or 50 different JavaScript calls which have the same effect as Evol. And if you want to log all of these, then you have to find the breakpoints for all of these. And I basically tried to get the breakpoint for document write. And yeah, I am no WinDBG master, and it was my first tour in WinDBG and IE, but it took me 3 or 4 hours to find the correct breakpoint for document write. So it's not really easy to do this. And if you are dealing with 50 different functions, and these breakpoint addresses are different from version to version, you can see that it can be bypassed in a practical level. So the conclusion of the reverse engineer is that a determined reverse engineer can still restore the exploit from a memory dump, for example, or a determined attacker reverse engineer can put breakpoints on the exploit-related functions, for example, when the exploit call calls virtual protect, or you can use guard pages, which is a new technique in Windows. And by using these guard pages, you can basically block the exploit in your debugger at the time when you can access all the exploit code. But I have discussed this method with multiple reverse engineers and blue team members, I am sure that this iron squirrel technique can delay the zero-day exploit discovery by days, weeks, months, or even years if implemented properly. Okay, so now you can deliver your exploit code in a safe way, and you run your shellcode in the victim browser. What is the next logical step? How many of you heard about the Gauss malware? Okay. What was really great in the Gauss malware that some of the payloads were encrypted in a way that it will only run in specific environments where the path variable was set to a specific string. And because no reverse engineer had access to this specific path string, no one knows what's inside that payload. And this whole idea was implemented in the open source Ebola project. If you don't know this project, I highly recommend you to check out, because it's a great project. In Ebola, you can use the same technique that first you encrypt your malware with something which is only available on the client, so it won't run on any other machine where the environment is different. Of course, if you are implementing your malware, you have to implement all the anti-stuff, which you can read anywhere, like anti-debugging, anti-memory forensics, disassemble, sandbox, dump, trace, whatever. There are 20 different anti-stuff which you should implement in your malware. Good news is that I have chained my Iron Squirrel exploit delivery with the Ebola malware, so they work together. So if you are looking at a Wireshark dump, you have basically no idea what happened here and what kind of malware was delivered here. If you are into archaeology and your victim still uses flash or Silverlight, it is possible to encrypt your exploit in Flash, for example, or in Silverlight, and pass the decrypt key parameters via the execution environment parameters. So this way you can also protect your Flash or Silverlight zero day, and the Flash exploit protection is already implemented in the private version of Iron Squirrel, which I don't want to publish. Okay, so as I mentioned, first I implemented the whole Iron Squirrel project in Node.js, then I ported it to Ruby so I can implement into Metasploit. And it turned out this is a bit harder than I expected. So this is the current Metasploit integration level 0.0. How it works, you run Metasploit with a fake victim, you extract all the HTML and JS and other files from the network dump, so the exploit became static. You put the HTML files into the Iron Squirrel exploit folder, and you run Iron Squirrel with the HTML file. It turned out Metasploit is a huge project, and if you want to add a new exploit module to it, it's pretty easy. But if you are messing with the core of Metasploit, things are a lot harder and more complicated. So if you know how Metasploit works inside and you are a core developer of Metasploit, I would like to contact you because I have a lot of questions how this can be solved. So is there a logo for Iron Squirrel? Yeah, this is not a vulnerability. And we know that logos are lame, so the logical answer should be that there is no logo, but I have created one. I mean, not myself, but I have a friend who can create cool logos like this. So this is the logo for Iron Squirrel. And now let's look at the big picture. I think one important thing we have to see that perimeter security is dying, and there is no perimeter nowadays. With all the mobile devices, and now that everything is encrypted, these perimeter defenses like next generation breach detection or IDS systems are gonna die because they cannot see what's really happening, because they are not on the where the network really network traffic really happens, or when they are there, everything is encrypted. And let's talk about the ethical dilemmas. I got the questions that why do I help the bad guys? Yeah. Now the question is, who are the bad guys? I think neither offense or defense is bad by itself. And my personal opinion is that whenever the FBI is catching the pedophiles on pedophile sites, I believe they are the good guys. There is a big but here, what will happen later, and we can discuss this at the fire, I think. And
also a lot of people doing this, huh? There's other bad guys doing stuff also.
Yes, exactly. And I believe in evolution. So if you have better defenses or you have better offense than the others, then you are gonna survive. And this whole presentation is about evolving the browser exploit kit scene. And last but not least, I totally agree that the current laws are really not prepared for law enforcement hacking of Tor users. Let me give you one example. Recently, the FBI hacked an Onion website where only Hungarian users were present, and the whole forum was in Hungarian, and the FBI just hacked it. What's really funny in the story that I passed this story to some guys in Hungary to write a cool article about it, and there was nothing about this. So I don't know really what happened here, but it's strange that basically FBI is hacking something which is Hungarian. Okay, and last but not least, we have to ask ourselves what happens if we don't prepare our defenses against these kind of attacks. And thank you for your attention.
Just comment about the evil eyes stuff. I think that you don't really need hooking the JavaScript functions because you can just use one of the open source browsers and patch the JavaScript engine, which I think would be easier than finding all those evil-like functions.
The problem with that approach is that usually how exploit kit works, first they detect all the versions and you can emulate anything, that's for sure, but again, in this case, you go down to the level where you have to change the source code of your browser to emulate a specific browser you know will be targeted. And last time I tried to compile a browser, it took a lot, lot of time and resources. So yeah, you can go down that path, but I'm not sure it will be efficient either. I think it will break on the plugin detect and browser detect, and it's sometimes very hard to fake that you are an Internet Explorer.
So I'm interested in what kind of queries do you use, and how are they implemented? Do you have a good feeling, or is there a lot of side channel leakage happening with this JavaScript crypto stuff? I mean, if because listening to you, I just had this huge desire of starting to do timing sidechain analysis on JavaScript crypto.
Okay, on the JavaScript side, I'm using the SGCL crypto library, Stanford JavaScript crypto library, whatever. I don't know the curve I'm using, and it will take me 10 minutes to check now because this is not the computer I used for development, so the code is not with me, but I will check this and I will let you know which curve I'm using. I believe it's a good one, but I'm sure you know this better.
I'm super interested.
Okay. Any questions?
Okay. So the ethical thing, you only said the bad guys might be the FBI, but you don't. You should list also the malware people there. It is not only about the FBI.
Problem is that, for example, if we are talking about companies like Hacking Team or Cellebrite, they usually sell their exploits to countries which don't respect democracy, for example, like in the case of Ahmed Mansour. So even there are issues in that case as well.
Yeah, but the anger kit is clearly crime.
Yes, and it's hard. I don't know the good answer for this. It's already out there, the cat out of the bag, because I had a long weekend. Yes?
Just one quick thought on the ethical dilemma. I think the argument could have been made without implementing it.
For example,
I see your point in proving that it works and everything, but I think, yeah.
I think it's pretty similar to Metasploit.
Yeah.
Like, we use Metasploit every day, and also I know that Metasploit is used in targeted attacks in a very bad fashion. So I think if we can allow Metasploit, then we should allow this project as well.